Hello and welcome. My name is John Dickinson for Boris Effects, and this particle illusion tutorial is all about forces and deflectors, how to use them to control the particles in your scene and also to add really realistic movement. So let's get started. I'm just going to search for the basic emitter just by typing in basic, coming down to custom emitters and double click basic to add that to the stage. This really is a very basic emitter. You can see not much is happening at all. So just going to twirl open the particle here and just increase the life and also the number and the velocity, just to push that out a little bit. We don't want too much movement because we're going to add the movement using forces. Something like that, and maybe just increase the number. And I'll bring the size down. Always adjust this later. Okay, great. I'm going to bring that down to the bottom of the stage. Just like that. And just twirl this up. So to add a force, we come up to the force button at the top of the stage. Click and then click on the stage. And that will add the default area type force. And you can see the parameters over here in the controls view. At the moment, it's not actually affecting the particles. That's because none of the particles are within the force area. So if I click and drag on the force and just move it so it's actually touching those particles, you can see it starts to push them in the direction of the arrow. The controls are pretty simple. You've got a type. The default is area. We also have grid and point. We'll look at those in a moment. Position X, Y. Strength. And strength can be negative, so you can actually get the particles to move in the opposite direction. There's a direction parameter, and you can see the arrow within the force is moving. And you can use angle to rotate the force object as a whole. And there's a width and height option. So I'm just going to position this just down here, below the emitter. And I'll make this a little taller, maybe something like that. And I'll just change the direction to 90, because I want these to shoot upwards like that. Something to keep in mind is that I've changed my preferences so that when I add objects to the stage, they start at frame 0. Just going to show you how to do that in preferences under the view menu. You can see the option down here, add new objects at frame 0, and I have that checked. If your object isn't at frame 0, and I play this back, it won't have any effect over the particle emitter until it hits the first frame of the force on the timeline. And this, of course, is valuable because there'll be times when you want the force to only affect the emitter at a certain point in time. But sometimes it can be a bit of a gotcha because you think you've added it at zero and nothing's happening. I want mine to affect it from zero. Going to bring that down a little bit. And let's add a second force. So once again, click on force and click. You can see multiple forces are useful for pushing the particles around in different directions. So you can control the direction and flow of the particles. I increase the strength here. You can see I can push those across to the right. But let's take a look at grid type. If I click on area and choose grid, have a look on the stage, nothing will actually happen other than the force being divided into a grid of cells. So the particles themselves actually haven't been affected. I just zoom in here, just hold down spacebar and left click to move that using the hand grabber tool. The grid type force is divided into cells, and if I just increase that slightly, now you can see that the arrows pop in there, and all of the arrows are pointing in that default direction from left to right. But grid's value is in these strength variation and direction variation options. Currently, the particles are moving through the force and they're being pushed to the right. But watch what happens to these arrows when I change direction variation. All of the arrows start to point in a different random direction, and you can see how that's breaking up this particle flow. And you're already starting to get a more wind-like motion to the particles. Just like that. What a difference that makes. So grid emitters are really powerful, especially for more organic particle simulations. There's also a strength variation option. Just drag that up a little bit. Particles, as they move through different cells, will be pushed at different velocities. And that's the same for direction. As they move through a different cell, they're pushed in the direction of that arrow. Really nice. Once you've got it set up, you can try different random seeds. You can get quite dramatically different results just by changing the random seed. See that? That's really blasting them out, isn't it? Just like that. And you probably could have created something like this using multiple area forces, but it would have taken a lot more work. I'm just going to increase the frames to preload just so we're not waiting for these particles to rise up. Yeah, looking good. And of course, you could animate the force as well. I just make this a bit bigger. And just set a couple of keyframes. I'll click on animate static mode. That's going to create a keyframe at 0 seconds. So now if I just click and drag the force, that's going to create a motion path. And I'll just animate that across. It moves across and starts affecting the particles. And you could also animate the direction. Let me just change that direction. So there's a fair few options, including direction variation, strength variation, animating the position, animating the angle, to get those particles to move in really unpredictable organic ways. You could also play around with the grid count. The default is 8 and 8. Changing the grid count will also change how the particles react when they're inside that grid force. Generally, I'll leave this at the default. Let me just uncheck that one and just remove those keyframes just by clicking constant and constant. And just by way of example, if I wanted to have them be affected a little later by that grid force, I can just drag the grid force to start a little later. So maybe the smoke is rising up and there isn't any wind, and then a wind gust comes through. So there's no wind at all, and then the wind gusts and whoosh, it whooshes through those particles. So lots of options for how you affect your particles with forces. I'm just going to delete that one. And let's just take a look at the last force type. Once again, I'm going to click force and click. And this time I'm going to change this one to a point. Just scale this up. The heads-up display is the fastest way to change the size. So the point force is a little different. With the point force, the particles are attracted to the center point. And this circle in the middle, this is your minimum distance. Any particles within the minimum distance aren't affected. I just drag that across. Let me just make that minimum distance. You can see it's too big now and only a few particles are being affected. So the particles will be attracted to the center point of this force. Just increase the strength. And these are really useful for controlling the flow and direction of particles in the scene. If I bring that down, you can see it's forcing those particles across to the left. And any of the particles that aren't within the force are just rising straight up. And if I just duplicate that by pressing Ctrl or Command D and just reposition that one, this one across to the left. So these particles are rising up and being attracted across to the left one, and these ones are being attracted to the right. you've got pretty good control over the direction of your particles using point forces. I could even duplicate that again. Just bring that one up into here and just give that a negative strength. And that'll repulse the particles. So that really splits them apart. If you do find that things are slowing down on the stage, it's a good idea just to decrease the particle number. So bring them down and maybe change the size up like that. And you'll find things will be a lot more responsive. Okay, so I'm just going to undo that now, and let's take a look at deflectors. Actually, just delete all of those forces. Just bring my emitter up a little bit, and let's just change this up. I'm going to change the shape to an area. Let's increase that size. Bring the velocity down. And there's way too many. Bring it down to 50. I'm just going to change the particle type or the shape image. For this one, I want to come down to sparkles. And I'm going to choose a bubble. And good. Probably can bring the velocity right down and increase the weight. Want these falling down like that. That's good. Maybe just increase the weight a little bit more. Okay, so let's add a deflector to the stage. By coming up and clicking on the deflector button, and then coming down to the stage and clicking. And this is the same as a line emitter, where you drag out the line and double-click to accept. And if we click and drag that second point, you can see as it moves across the particle stream, they get deflected. Deflectors are fairly simple. We've only got a few parameters. The first is angle, where you can change the angle of the deflector. And of course, you could animate this. One thing to keep in mind, though, is that deflectors can't actually push particles. Bounce controls the amount of bounce. And this is dependent on whether the particle's bounce parameter is above zero. Currently, this is above zero. If I make that zero, you can see the particles don't bounce at all. The deflector does have some effect, but most of the particles are just falling through. And this is the same as if I'd set the bounce value to zero. So if you want them to hit the deflector but not bounce, you have to have at least 0.1 for this setting, just like that. And if you did want some of the particles to fall through, you can control that using the hits. At the moment it's set to 100, so no particles are falling through. But if you wanted to make it a little more porous, just drop that setting slightly and some of the particles will fall through. Let me just make that 99. So that gives that a slightly more porous effect. Use thickness if you want to make it appear as if the particles are hitting a plane. This is also useful for creating pipe-like effects. I'll just bring my hits back up to 100. And you can create multi-segment deflectors. Just going to click again. Click on the stage, click, and then double click to accept. And you can use a number of different deflectors to really control the flow of your particles, just like you can with forces. So that should give you a clearer understanding of how you can use forces and deflectors to move particles around your scene. So go ahead and use them now to control the flow of particles in your particle simulations. You can download Particle Illusions standalone for free at borisfx.com including thousands of free particle emitter presets. Continue watching this Getting Started tutorial series to learn more about what you can do with Particle Illusion and find out more about the plugin version of Particle Illusion with extra features, including built-in Mocha motion tracking at boriseffects.com.